Hi everyone, I'm Dennis. I'm from the Department of Engineering at the University of Cambridge, along with my co-authors, Ines Bucic and Bernard Chipmans. Today we're presenting our work on 3D human body shape and pose prediction from a single RGB image. A key difference from other works is that we are able to make such predictions without requiring a single pair of image corresponding body shape and pose. Now, if you have a data set for you, a standard approach to tracking 3D human body shape and pose prediction could consist of designing a CNN that takes as its input the RGB image and predicts the shape and pose parameters desired. When training, a straightforward loss function between the predicted and ground truth values could be applied. In this work, we refer to such a method as direct learning, since we directly apply the loss on the desired output. Direct learning has worked well for tasks where the labeled data can be obtained easily. Tasks like image classification or semantic segmentation. However, for predictions as complex as the human body models we desire here, direct learning might not be as applicable as the labeling would be very costly. We propose instead a general scheme we call indirect learning. Indirect learning makes use of much simpler ground truth labels that perhaps already exist in substantial quantity. In this figure, for example, it's hand-labeled body silhouettes. The core of the idea is that the loss is applied between predictions and labels of different domains. Such a scheme would make full use of all sorts of existing data sets. For our problem, this includes body part segmentation and 2D joining. For this work, however, we use only body silhouette labels to exemplify the method. Now, the obvious question here is, how can you apply a loss between these two different domains? The answer lies in the loss function. So, while conceptually we call this purple layer a loss function, it is in fact made out of two parts. A decoder that transforms prediction to the same domain as the label, followed by the much more familiar cross-entropy loss. Now this figure shows what a full network actually looks like now that we've expanded the loss function into its constituent parts. The overall architecture is an encoder-decoder. The encoder, that's the function that we ultimately want. It takes the input RGB image and produces a desired prediction of the 3D shape in both parameters. These parameters are then decoded to the matching domain of per pixel binary foreground background labels. Finally, we apply cross entropy between the decoder output and the ground truth. Now, I just want to clarify something. Here and in other figures, I rendered the equivalent 3D body model, but that's just for visualization purposes. In fact, we are operating on a vector of 82 values. And these 82 values are defined by a modeling framework that we use here, as far as I'm here. So there are total 82 parameters, 10 to shape and 72 to pose. In this work, however, we reduce the problem, we operate on only 33 of the most significant parameters, and we restrict the main rotation to 72 degrees above the major axis, and we further normalize these parameters. So note that a byproduct of this modeling scheme is that the representation is structured insofar that every parameter is strictly interpretable. In the first example, one particular pose parameter controls the swing of the model's right leg. Another parameter controls the shape of the person you can see, and the model becomes thinner as we vary that. So back to our architecture diagram, we've got this all laid out. So the next part is the training procedure. Step one, we train the renderer decoder. This takes as input the shape and pose parameters and predicts as output the corresponding silhouettes. And so we can train this entirely with artificial rendered data points. After training, the decoder weights are frozen. Conceptually, then, the decoder and the cross-entropy loss that follows can be combined and thought of as one deep learned loss function that acts directly between the shape and pose parameter domain and the silhouette domain. With the decoder trained and fixed, the next step is to train the encoder, and now all that we need are pairs of input RGB image and corresponding silhouettes. So the exact architecture that we use is shown in this figure. In our work, we explored several designs for both the encoder and decoder, but we will cover only the one shown for this presentation. As laid out earlier in the training procedures, the first step now is training the decoder. So the decoder can be broken down into three conceptual parts. The first is the translation unit, so that comprises three fully connected layers and a reshaped layer. The translation unit converts the decoder into from the 3D human body model parameter domain, the silhouette image domain. But this resulting image is too small, and the images there are 9x9 resolution, so we use the expansion unit to enlarge this image grid. Finally, the learning unit compresses the multi-channel output to 2-channel image to 64x64 pixel resolution. We train the decoder on 100,000 pairs of shape and pose parameters in the corresponding silhouettes, and we evaluate the performance for 1,000 more such pairs. Each data point is generated by sampling the parameters independently from the uniform distribution between minus 1 and 1, with the rendered silhouette centered in the image in 10% boundary around. So here I show some examples of data pairs. Again, to be clear, the inputs have been rendered as 3D models, but not just vectors of shape and pose parameters. And it worked. This video shows the decoder's rendering of the silhouettes when one shape, rotation, or pose parameter is varied. As you can see, the predicted silhouette that's on the bottom right side matches the real silhouette from the SMPL rendering package. So that's the one on the left. In numbers, the decoder predicts a silhouette with a foreground intersection over union score of 84%. And with the decoder training, we can now move on to training our encoder. So again, just like the decoder, we conceptualize the encoder as three separate units. The first of these is an appearance unit, so that's a VGG-like network, and it consists of multiple convolutional ReLU and max pooling layers, and that learns appearance features. We follow that with the compression unit that applies further convolution ReLUs and max pooling in order to produce output feature maps of 64-channel resolution 1x1. We include this compression unit so that we can make full use of all the spatial information available. And finally, as with the decoder, we have a translation unit to move from the image domain to the structured representation domain that we need. So we evaluate this design on some artificial data sets first. We explore two different training schemes, direct and indirect learning. As I explained earlier, direct learning involves applying a loss directly between the predicted and the ground truth pre-human model parameters. So here we use Euclidean distance between the two vectors. Note that we still apply a forward pass through the decoder just to obtain the decoder rendered silhouette for visualization and evaluation. So some of the example data points are shown. We generated two different data sets. So this one where the input images have a very small noise added, and this one where the input images are corrupted with a significant amount of noise as well as artificial rectangular occlusions. So just like the decoder, we use 100,000 data points for training and we evaluate 1,000 more with the same sampling. We evaluate three metrics here, predicted model silhouette and predicted silhouette accuracies, as well as mean landmark distance. Predicted model silhouette refers here to the silhouette predicted model that's generated with the SMPL package, while predicted silhouette refers instead to the output of the renderer decoder. So in other words, if you have a perfect decoder, these two things are going to be the same. The last one is mean LM distance, so that's a measure of the fit between the predicted and ground truth 3D models. So 91 landmarks around the model are selected as shown. We measure the distance between where each landmark is in the predicted model and where it is in the ground truth model, and we take mean. And here you can see that this entire design works. The first column shows the RGB input image. The second column shows the ground truth model and silhouettes. And finally, the third and fourth column show the predictions by the direct and indirect learning networks. Here we show a few more examples and report the numbers that should speak for themselves. Unsurprisingly, with direct learning, the mean LM distance is smaller, which means that it does predict better 3D models. Importantly, however, indirect learning is not much worse at all. And in fact, outperforms direct learning when it comes to the silhouette accuracy metrics. There are some scenarios that are particularly challenging that we found for indirect learning, and one of which is in the event of self-exclusion, as you can see in this figure. In the ground truth model, the person is covering his mouth, and this is captured also by the direct learning network. The indirect learning network does not get this quite correct, and the cause of this is clear from the silhouette image. Because the arm and the body are overlaid, the indirect learning network does not receive any feedback that it has gotten the arm position wrong at all. Another observation you can see in this figure is that the encoder in the indirect learning network favors settling in position in the manifold where the decoder output is sharper. These results are obtained also with the second artificial data set. Numerical scores here again confirm the pattern that we observed. Here is another ambiguity that indirect learning fails to resolve. But I want to draw your attention instead to a more exciting phenomenon. In the input image, the model's left forearm and hand are entirely occluded. However, because of the structured representation, both direct and indirect learning methods successfully predict that the hand and forearm must lie within the small occlusion. Finally, we conducted an experiment on some real images. So direct and indirect learning are as before, but we explored also an option in the middle, mixed learning, where we attach the grassroots parameter labels to only 20% of the data set. So these three schemes were created on about 1,300 real images and evaluated on 140 more. And we got the grassroots parameter labels from the 9 deeper data set. And here are some of the example results that we obtained. Now these are quite preliminary, but without doubt, the indirect learning method makes meaningful predictions. Of course, because we use such a small data set for these much more complicated real-world images, the 3D models predicted here are not quite as good as the artificial experiments, but the method certainly looks very specific. Here we can see some more qualitative results, and here are the numbers that matter. As you can see, the mixed learning approach falls perfectly between the direct and indirect learning methods, validating what we think is happening beneath the surface. Remember, at the end of the day, for both the artificial and real image experiments, the indirect learning network was trained only on such simple data sets, pairs of input images, and their corresponding silhouettes. In summary, in this world, we dealt with the challenging problem of making complex shapes and pose predictions without a large ground truth data set. We made use of the indirect deep structured learning approach to perform training using much more cheaply obtained silhouette data sets. The key steps for this scheme are 1, to train the decoder on artificial data, and 2, to freeze and fix this decoder one string, and then using it to train the desired encoder. By placing the desired output in the middle as the bottleneck of the encoder decoder, indirect learning allows data sets of all domains to be used together in a multitask training scheme, making full use of all existing resources. We believe that this would also greatly improve the performance of the network. And finally, I start off the presentation by saying, if you have the data set for it, you can just apply direct learning. In our experiments, we found that direct learning really produced better body models, predictions, and the motivation for indirect learning was the lack of availability of data sets. Although there are indeed data sets starting to be released for this problem, we believe that indirect learning is still relevant as we begin to model other classes of objects. If you want to model animals or cars, you don't have to start from square one and create your own expensive complex labels. You can use indirect learning. Thank you.
Any questions?
So, first of all, when you place your renderer, or hard code renderer, with a learned renderer, I was wondering why do that? I realize you get differentiation, you get that far. But you also get something with soft boundaries and a little bit inaccurate. So I'm wondering if you get something else as well. If you get some value, fuzzy boundaries that regularizes, or how do the inaccuracies in the renderer, the learned renderer, affect the performance? And what would happen if it were perfect and get pretty sharp boundaries?
So we had a few different decoders performances, but we found that the overall effect of the sharpness of the boundaries and the accuracy of the decoder past a certain level, it doesn't really make much difference because at the end of the day it settles to, the encoder peaks. Yes, the decoder doesn't have to be perfect because even if you chop off the tip of your head, it's reasonable that this that the chopped off hand's arm thing fits the same predicted model. So, therefore, without, and as for why we didn't use a hard-coded decoder renderer as opposed to a learned one, I think the general principle here is that so that we can apply it to a multi-task training team for all sorts of stuff that we have. Thanks.
So it sounds like when you do the interaction case is taking a high dimensional problem and loss in a lower dimensional version of the problem. It seems to be quite a good example for cases in which you like use a discriminator for training. Have you tried that?
No, we haven't tried discriminator for training. So to be clear, you mean a discriminator to see whether the predicted body shape and pose are reasonable. Do you mean that?
So basically use a bond structure discriminator and giving both the round trip silhouette and the focus silhouette the same discriminator and train to say which one is round trip and which one is generated by the decoder.
I'm not sure where that what we use that for, but
you mean taking into account.
Sorry, I'm not quite getting the situation for approach such as that.
Okay.
We'll talk about it.
Thanks. Thanks.